So I'm not going to talk about climate change at all.
Oh, I thought you said you
were. I'm happy to, take questions on that, if you're interested. But actually, you know, my background in climate has brought me, into a lot of the mathematics and physics of nonlinear dynamical systems, sort of things Nick talked about. I suppose what I want to do is to, just as Nick, that was a great, actually, having that talk first was a really nice introduction, because in a sense what Nick did to biology, i.e. used nonlinear dynamical ideas to sort of draw out some of the synergies and integral structure in structures in biology, I want to do the same for the universe as a whole. And in so doing, try to suggest some new approaches to understanding some of the dilemmas in quantum foundations. And maybe towards the end, suggest some possible ideas also about the marriage of quantum physics and gravitational physics. I should say, my PhD was in general relativity under the cosmologist Dennis Sharma. So I'm kind of just returning to my roots by discussing this work. So I do need to thank Basil. I think when I first approached you, Basil, with some of these ideas, you were, perhaps I was going to say a little, if not a lot, sceptical. But I think it's been...
I think it would be more, how is he going to do that, rather than sceptical.
But what I've really appreciated is, you and George in the audience, the ability to discuss these ideas with the real world's experts at these wonderful workshops in Askosta in Sweden, which...
I thank George for that.
Well, I know George, I'm thanking George, but I also thank you, Basil, for, I'm sure you influenced George in allowing me to come and talk about these things. And I have to say, just giving a talk, there's nothing like having to give a talk about stuff you're not necessarily 100% confident about to world experts to kind of focus your mind. So just the act of giving a talk has helped me develop ideas a lot. I want to kind of suggest towards the end that the ideas I'm going to suggest today are not actually, I think, a million miles away from Bohmian types of quantum mechanics. And I will end with a kind of a speculation about the link between these ideas and Bohmian theory, and in particular the quantum potential. So let me just start by summarizing the three ways in which one which one is faced with when confronting the sort of foundational problems in quantum mechanics. For example, the Bell theorem throws up. You've got to give up something that you might otherwise have cherished, certainly from classical physics, and the question is, which one do you want to give up? The notion that the world is somehow realistic, we have definite, things have definite properties and evolve in definite ways, or that there is some breakdown in our notions of causality, in the sense that maybe it's not true what we're taught in relativity, that events are determined by data in the past light cones of these events. And I suppose quantum theory you'd give up on that first one, and I suppose at least most people interpret Bohmian mechanics as somehow violating the second notion, although I'll come back to that. Now the third one is a little bit more technical, and it's usually also dismissed as unsatisfactory for two reasons, which I'll talk about in a second. So it's called this idea of measurement independence. But if we assume that particles have definite properties, what we used to call have hidden variables, I think the lingo these days is called ontic variables, and that we want to tease out these properties by doing measurements. The measurement independent hypothesis says that the measurements we do on our particles shouldn't depend on what the values of those ontic variables are. And this is often called the free will assumption, that somehow experimenters are free to do whatever they want to do. They shouldn't be somehow influenced by the values of the variables associated with the particles. John Bell himself did some sort of quite incisive analysis of this third condition, and in a sense he drew the conclusion that this notion of free will is a little bit of a red herring, and the more important objection to this notion of measurement independence is that it seems to suggest, if you do postulate that measurement independence is violated, that somehow the world is very, very, very fine-tuned, that any tiny perturbation would destroy the precise measurement dependent situations that you'd set up. And this often goes by the notion of conspiracy. There's something conspiratorial about the universe that just doesn't seem right, doesn't seem to marry with our intuition. So whether you view it from this conspiracy idea, fine-tuning idea, or free will idea, people in general don't like the idea of violating the third of these conditions either. So in a sense, we're still, I think, in a bit of a conundrum about what really is going on in physics. And what I want to do in this talk is actually suggest that this third condition is one that we perhaps haven't given enough attention to, and that there are subtle issues that may actually help resolve things like the Bell theorem in favour of both determinism and local causality. Now you might say, although I'm sure nobody here would say, but I'm sure a lot of people in physics departments around the world would sort of say, who cares about any of this? This is a bit too metaphysical. I think my own view and I have to say a lot of these things I've been very much influenced by Roger, is that it may be, well, first of all, it may be that the grossly inaccurate estimates of dark energy from quantum field theory might be an indication that quantum theory is actually going wrong in situations where gravity is important. And that secondly, if we want to develop a theory where we can estimate things like dark energy and dark matter in a consistent way, i.e. develop a theory of quantum physics which is not going to go wrong in situations where gravity is important, then we really have to sort out these foundational issues. I don't think that just calling it non-locality, if you like, and sweeping it under the carpet is going to be good enough. So anyway, that's certainly my sort of motivation for this. All right, let's start with a bit of first year undergraduate mathematics, which may seem an unlikely place to start, but this will become apparent as we go on. So I'm going to write down a sequence of rational approximations to the square root of 2, decimal truncations of the square root of 2. And we're taught in, as I say, in first year maths that this is an example of a Cauchy sequence, which means that if we took any two numbers sufficiently far along the sequence and calculated the Euclidean distance between those two numbers, using that formula, modulus of a minus b, then that distance gets smaller and smaller as we go further along the sequence. And a sort of mathematically sophisticated way of actually defining the square root of 2 is as the whole Cauchy sequence itself. So that's kind of standard maths. So with that in mind, consider the following sequence. The first element is 1. The second element is 1 plus 2. The third element is 1 plus 2 plus 2 squared. The fourth element, 1 plus 2 plus 2 squared plus 2 cubed. And so on. I just keep adding the higher orders of 2 to that sequence. Now, you know, based on your first year undergraduate training, if you were asked the question, is that a Cauchy sequence, you would say absolutely not, because these numbers are actually diverging. as we get further and further down the sequence. So the distance between the two members of the sequence getting bigger rather than smaller, so it's certainly not a Cauchy sequence. However, it turns out it is a Cauchy sequence, providing you define your notion of distance correctly. And there is a metric called the two-adic or diadic metric, which I've defined here, where actually that sequence is Cauchy. The two-adic metric, so if I write p equals to 2 in this formula here, I'm basically 2 to the minus, and then this function ord, it's called ord sub p or sub 2 of a minus b, and ord sub 2 of x is the highest power of x, highest power of 2 that divides x. So if I take the distance between 1 plus 2 plus 2 squared and 1 plus 2, the difference is 2 squared, and that distance function is 2 to the minus 2, which is a quarter, and for higher elements it gets smaller and smaller. Now this might seem completely kind of crazy, it's certainly not intuitive as I stated it there, but from a purely mathematical point of view, that metric satisfies all the axioms of a metric. It satisfies a triangle inequality, it's positive definite, and so on and so forth. So it's all the sort of things that the metric should satisfy. And it turns out that just as you can define the real numbers in terms of these completions of Cauchy sequences relative to the Euclidean norm, you can also define a different type of completion of the rational numbers using this p-adic distance function. And the field q sub p are called the p-adic numbers. Now, as I say, if you were to read just the maths and the number theory, it would seem quite very counterintuitive, actually, and it's hard to know what these things could ever have to do with physics. And actually, for that reason, I think they've had very little impact in physics. However, an important point to make, and one I'll come to pretty much in the next sentence, is that there are geometric interpretations of these metrics, and in particular the Euclidean distance is the sort of thing that you use when you're talking about or trying to analyse properties of Euclidean geometries. However, the p-adic distance, the p-adic metric, is what you would naturally use if you wanted to analyse properties or do analysis, if you like, on fractal geometries. Now, I'm afraid the next quotation is definitely name-dropping here, but I was fortunate to have dinner with Andrew Wiles and talk to him a little bit about p-adic numbers, and he got very excited about the possibility that these things may play a role in physics, and we exchanged a few little emails backwards and forwards after the dinner, and he allowed me to use this quote, which was in one of his emails, that we number theorists tend to work almost as much p-adically as with the reals or complexes, complex numbers, nowadays, and in fact it is usually best to consider all at once. And I'm sure those of you who know Fermat's Last Theorem, the p-adics play a big role in the establishment of the Fermat Last Theorem. So I want to also take this, it's interesting by the way that, complex numbers we don't have any difficulty with. These were a mathematical invention, but they've become completely embedded in physics. So we certainly work with reals and complex numbers on an equal basis. I want to suggest that the p-adics also thinks that we should be treating with the same level of importance. My own view is if we were taught fractal geometry at school rather than the standard Euclidean geometry, we may well be much more familiar with these number systems than we actually are. And in particular, I want to talk about the use of the p-adics for describing, or p-adic distance functions for describing distances in state space or phase space, recognizing that the Euclidean distance is very much the preferred measure in space-time. I have a kind of sense in which the Euclidean and the p-adic distance are a bit like explicate and implicate orders in Bohmian thinking. So just to make this a little bit more, this link to fractals a bit more precise, this is the famous Cantor ternary set, where you throw away sort of the middle, you do an iterative process and throw away the middles of these intervals. So the actual Cantor set being the intersection of all these iterates, where you're throwing away all the middle bits of the remaining parts of your iteration. And this function f, or this mapping rather f, is a mapping from the Cantor set. So that's a point. So that's a point on the Cantor set, and which basically is you could think of it as think of it in base 3. Then it's all the numbers in base 3 which either have the digit 0 or 2. So if a is either 0 or 1, you've either got zeros or twos on the numerator. So the sum of all these gives you a point on the Cantor set. And this is a mapping to one of those sequences I showed of, you know, powers of 2. And these numbers are a subset of the p-adic or the dyad 2-adic numbers called the 2-adic integers. And this mapping generalizes from a ternary set to a Cantor set which, instead of having two elements, has p elements. So basically, you divide the unit interval not into... in a ternary set, you divide it into three parts and throw away the middle part. So that's where you've got p equals 2. But it works more generally where you divide it into 2p minus 1 parts and then throw away every second sub-interval and just keep iterating. And the whole point about p-adic numbers is that you can do all the things that you normally would do, like algebra, calculus, Fourier analysis, all these sort of things, basically on Cantor sets with these p-adic numbers. Now, I just want to make... And this is where the physical intuition, I think, becomes a bit clearer about what this distance function is telling you from the physical point of view. So here's the ternary set again, and I've drawn two points which, in some sense, are close together with respect to the Euclidean norm. So you could think of the set as embedded in this sort of Euclidean 2 space, and then here are two points where the Euclidean distance between them is very small. Now, using that bijection from the Cantor set to the p-adics, then you can very easily show that if the two points lie on the fractal, on the Cantor set, then, and the Euclidean distance is small, then also the p-adic distance will be small. So as long as you're on the Cantor set, then the Euclidean and p-adic distances sort of pretty much correspond to each other. However, if one point, for example, was on the p-adic set, on the Cantor set, and the other point wasn't, then the p-adic distance is at least equal to p, or it could be p squared or p cubed, but it's at least equal to p. Now, if p is a large number, so instead of 2 here, think of p as a very large number, then it's telling you that two points which are not both on the Cantor set, even though they look very close together in this Euclidean sense, will be very, very far apart in the p-adic sense. Now, we can put this a little bit more physically, and this is relevant to what I want to talk about. If you have a physical system where you think lying on this fractal set in state space is important, and you consider a hypothetical perturbation which takes you off this Cantor set, then although in the Euclidean distance sense it might seem a small perturbation to the system, in the p-adic sense it's a very large perturbation to the system. So this is a very important point which we'll come to shortly. Okay, so why worry about any of this? What's this got to do with physics? And this is where my sort of background in climate comes in, I suppose, because systems which have fractal invariant sets in their state space are quite generic. Nick talked about these sorts of things for biological systems. I mean, these are very generic to certain classes of nonlinear dynamical systems. Famously, Ed Lorentz, meteorologist who I knew quite well, discovered in '63 this link between just differential equations, nonlinear differential equations and these fractal sets in state space. If you define your system by the differential equations and start at any odd point you like, x, y, and z in state space and integrate forwards, the asymptotic behavior of the system was that it'll evolve closer and closer to one of these fractal sets, which actually have measure zero. They have zero volume in the three-dimensional state space, but they exhibit all the sort of complex chaotic dynamics that we know are associated with chaotic systems. And locally, and this is, I think, one of Lorentz's great achievements in science, he realized that the structure of these sets is locally the product of the real line, which are the trajectories cross. So the transverse structure is that of a Cantor set. Now, this is all classical physics. So, you know, we know that the world of quantum physics is not classical. So we have to, if these ideas are to have any traction at all, we have to say something about, you know, that isn't classical. So I want to introduce a concept which I wrote about a few years ago now, as I say, thanks to Basil and the invitations to talk about this in Sweden, and I called it the cosmological invariant set postulate. And I snuck in this phrase actually this morning, having heard the first talk, that it really is a manifestation, I think, of this notion of undivided wholeness. And that is to think of the universe, first of all, think of the universe as a dynamical system, and there are many, that itself is not a particularly revolutionary idea, but, and by the way, let me just, sorry, one thing I didn't say. Interestingly, this linkage between the differential equations and the fractal set in state space is quite a non-trivial one, and in fact, if you wanted to, for example, if you chose at random a point in state space and asked the question, does that point belong to that fractal set or not? You might say, well, can I use the governing differential equations to determine whether that point, my chosen point, belongs to the invariant set or not? It turns out that there's no finite algorithm that would decide that in general. So this is an example of this relationship between the differential equations on the one hand and the geometry on the other. Is an example of something, again, that Roger has talked about in his books, of a non-computable, non-algorithmic relationship or system. And that's something, again, I should come back to. So what I want to do here is kind of turn the cart and the horse about, if you like, and just conjecture that the most primitive expression of the laws of physics is not differential equations, either in states, in space-time, or state space, or configuration space, or any space you like. But rather, it's a mathematical representation of some geometry in state space, of the universe as a whole. And in particular, I'm going to develop this notion that this geometry has this fractal structure. And that's why I'm postulating that this p-adic metric is the natural metric to talk about of doing analysis in state space. So by moving from the differential equations to the geometry as the primitive expression, I am now departing from classical physics. And the reason I'm saying that is that if you postulate the differential equations as your primitive object, then you can integrate from any point you like in state space. There's nothing preferred about one point or another point. But when you say there is something intrinsically important about this geometry, then you're attaching ontological significance to the points that are on the geometry, and attaching no ontological significance at all to points which are not on the geometry. And that's definitely non-classical. That's not something which you would get from a set of differential equations. It comes from, as I say, turning the cart and the horse around and postulating that it's the geometry that's the important thing here. Equations. So this is something that is realistic in the sense that there's no stochastic processes here, everything's completely deterministic. I'm not going to violate local causality in any sense, but I am doing something that's not classical. So just to give you a bit more meat on the bones here, Because what I want to do is look at one of the classic examples in quantum mechanics of the quantum interferometer and sort of try to look at it again in this slightly different light. So I want to sort of give you a schematic picture of sort of how I'm thinking about this. So I want to give you a, this is not the whole thing, but just a little bit, if you like, of this fractal geometry and where it takes us to. And it's going to be based on essentially a geometric model of these p-adic integers. So the idea is you have a trajectory, just if you'd like to single out somehow the trajectory of that Lorentz attractor, but now this is to be thought of as the trajectory of the state space of the universe as a whole. At some level of iteration, which I'll call k, c sub k, denotes some kind of iterate number. And because it denotes some iterate, it means if I zoomed in to a higher iterate, I would see some structure. I'm going to say a bit more about what this structure is in a second. So zoom out again, it just looks like a single trajectory. But now it undergoes some kind of splitting, a bit like the bifurcation that Nick talked about, into separate basins of attraction. So in Nick's work, these would be different phenotypes or something. So in my model, these are different eigenstates. This is what in quantum theory you'd call eigenstates of some measurement operator, where this would be a kind of qubit type system where you have.
Are you assuming a measurement is taking place at T1, or is it just naturally evolving?
Well, I'm assuming it's naturally evolving, and we call it experimentally a measurement, but it's not. It's evolving. Actually, I'm very much attracted to the idea, again, that Roger has developed, and with others, that this might actually be somehow gravitationally induced, and these would actually correspond at this level to gravitationally distinct space-times, which would satisfy some criterion. This is what we would call a measurement, but it's just an instability induced by the underlying physics, of which I think gravity probably is part. So now we split these things apart, and we might take one of these trajectories, each one is a space-time, and then we're now at a slightly higher level of iteration, so we've kind of unraveled this fractal structure here. But now, at a yet higher level, there's more fractal structure as fractals continue. And these can be also drawn apart by instabilities further on. Now, there's a crucial number here, p equals 2 to the n plus 1. The 2 to the n really are the trajectories at each level. This splitting kind of gives rise to 2 to the n trajectories, which either go to the red attractor or to the blue. There's one that kind of sits on this highly unstable point in the middle. But you have 2 to the n, which are either red or blue, either one basin of attraction or the other, or one eigenstate or the other. So, with that in mind, we can sort of link these individual sort of trajectory strands in a statistical way to the familiar complex Hilbert space of quantum mechanics. So, what we call the eigenstate is just the red trajectories. A red eigenstate would be the red trajectories, and the blue eigenstate the blue trajectories. And this is a probability. I'll come to this complex phase in a moment. But these thetas give you the probability amplitude. So we want the cosine squared. So the cosine squared of theta over 2 would give you the number of trajectories in this 2 to the n bundle of trajectories, which go to the red, and sine squared theta over 2 is the probability, so it's essentially the number of blue trajectories divided by the total of 2 to the n.
Tim, you mentioned that you're saying about gravity coming, or Faulkner.
Yes.
How does that work in this sense? How would that make this happen? I'm a bit puzzled why that statement.
Well, this could be a situation like, you know, doing a Stone Gerlach experiment, mm-hmm. and the beam splits, and then they get, you know, detected by big detectors. Mm-hmm. And at the stage, I mean, this is something that Rogers argued, at the stage where you know, one detector has in a macroscopic sense, changed compared to the other detector, then one could say that, in some sense, the two space-times, one with the detector, so one detector moving and the other space-time with the other detector moving, are kind of significantly different at some kind of gravitational level. There's a non-negligible gravitational energy momentum difference between these two space-times. So that's what that idea is trying to capture. So if these cosines describe frequentist probabilities, it better be the case that these cosines are, in a sense, rational. So I'm using this terminology Q of n to mean that cosine is a rational number which can be described by n bits, because that means it's some number divided by 2 to the n. So that's an important condition on this correspondence existing. Now there's a second condition which is to do with the complex phase, and I just want to have a, which is slightly different, because it's not the cosine of the phase, but the phase itself, as a fraction of pi, must be a rational number. So just to give you a flavour of where that all comes from, this is the way I try to incorporate complex numbers, or indeed where they naturally occur in this type of dynamical systems approach to quantum theory. So let me keep it as something fairly simple. Let me just imagine, so just, you can view this almost as a standalone slide, you don't need to relate it immediately to anything previously. So imagine you've got four bits, which can either be 0 or 1, or just to relate it to the previous slide, they can be red lines or blue lines. And I have an operator, which I call a not operator, or a negation operator, which takes a 0 to a 1, or 1 to a 0, or red to a blue, or blue to a red. And let me just define an operator, which I'm going to call e to the I pi over 4, but just treat it as some operator, on that string S, which kind of commutes the order of the symbols to not A4, A3, A1, A2. So that's just the definition. Well, that's an interesting definition, because if you operate again with that same operator, you can almost do this in your head if you like, but you end up with not A2, A1, not A4, A3, and I'll define that to be e pi over 2, so it's just taking these two things twice. And then if I operate on e to the I pi over 2 of S, again that same e to the I pi over 2 operator by this, I get to the not operator acting on all four of these strings, which you could define as the negation of the string itself. So basically, working backwards, e to the I pi over 2 is a square root of minus 1, and e to the I pi over 4 is a square root of e to the I pi over 2. And I can generalize that to having just generally 2 to the n instead of 2 to the 2, 2 to the n bits, and it allows me to define a whole sort of multiplicative group of operators which are completely isomorphic to the multiplicative group of unit complex numbers, providing pi, phi over pi is describable by n bits. So that's this second condition here on this correspondence, which allows me to link these trajectories to Hilbert space states.
Tim, just a reminder, what was the correspondence between the cosines and these?
Well, cosine is merely describing the fraction of trajectories which are red compared to blue. So at this level, it's just merely describing that frequentist probability. All right. So with that in mind, let's go to this sort of iconic quantum experiment, the quantum Lamarck-Sender interferometer. So in standard quantum theory, I might prepare my system in a certain input state, and it goes through the interferometer, and it comes out with this output state where D and E correspond to the two measurement arms, the two arms at the output of the interferometer. And that's achieved by, you know, applying the standard unitary evolution operators to the input state. So we could say in this notion that there is a correspondence between these Hilbert space vectors and this sort of structure on this fractal set, we can say providing this cosine phi is one of these rational numbers, then I can say, okay, there's some, this output state corresponds to some bit string, which in turn corresponds to some sample space, if you like, of trajectories on the invariant set. So I would assume that. I would assume phi is of that type, and that allows me to say that this experiment, you know, corresponds to something definite on my state space for the universe. Okay. But now here's the whole point of all this. As we know, the problems arise with these types of experiments when we start to ask which way the particle went through the interferometer. So let's ask that question. Let's ask that question. Which way did it go through the interferometer? So to answer that question, we might want to halt the unitary evolution process at the stage where it's gone through the first beam splitter and the phase shifter, and then the quantum state at this intermediate level is of this type. Okay, now we can do some interesting, apply a kind of elementary result in number theory. Let's assume that this phi, you see, let's assume the phi is somewhere between 0 and pi by 2. We could try and make it very close to 0. We could try for all practical purposes to make phi 0, but phi will never be precisely 0. There will always be some experimental uncertainty in the value of phi. So I'm going to assume phi is somewhere between 0 and pi by 2, but not precisely 0 or pi by 2. Then I can apply number theory to tell me that if I've already assigned phi to be a number whose cosine has this rational nature, I'm using this pointer, that implies that phi itself, as a fraction of pi, cannot be rational. So a very simple example is, if you take, suppose you had phi equals pi over 4, the cosine is 1 over root 2, which is irrational. Take any value of phi, which is, you know, 3 pi over 8, or 31 pi over 32, or anything where it's describable by n bits, its cosine will be irrational. Or conversely, if you choose an irrational cosine phi, the phi will be irrational. So according to my prescription, now there is no corresponding bit string to this state vector. In other words, this experiment, which is a counterfactual experiment, it's the experiment where I say for the particular particle where I actually did an interference experiment, if I try to find out which way it went through, if I imagine a counterfactual world where I instead had measured which way it went through the interferometer, that counterfactual world would not lie in this approach to being a state of the universe, because it won't lie on this invariant set. Now, your first reaction to this, I'm sure, is that this is fine-tuning gone mad, because I'm sort of attributing something, as I say, of ontological significance to a value of a variable phi, or a phase angle phi. I'm attributing ontological significance to whether it's describable by n bits, where n could be an enormously large number, 10 to the 100 or something, as opposed to being truly irrational. Now, in most physics sort of thinking, that sounds completely barking mad to say, you know, it really matters whether phi can be described by, you know, 10 to the 100 bits as opposed to an infinite number of bits. And this is where the pianics come back, because this is where they give you a different perspective on size and what you mean by size. And this is why this is relevant to this whole issue of fine-tuning and conspiracy and all the rest of it in the Bell theorem. So what we've kind of imagined a universe, which I'll call U1, where we do the interferometer experiment. This is the Mark Sender interferometer with the phase shifter set at some value phi. And we're saying that's what happened in the real world. So U1 is by definition an element of this invariant set. U2 is our hypothetical world where we kept the phase angle absolutely the same. This is a counterfactual world, but now we imagine a which way experiment. And we're saying that because this puts a different restriction on phi when you do a which way experiment compared to an interferometer experiment, then U2 doesn't lie on this invariant set. Well, we could imagine then a third experiment where we twiddle phi now to some phi prime, such that this was now an allowable angle to do a which way experiment. So U3 is now a counterfactual experiment, which is on the invariant set, it's just some distance from the real one in phase space. So now we've got two angles, let's focus on the which way experiments. We've got two which way experiments, one where phi isn't allowed, where phi isn't, doesn't satisfy the right constraint, phi over pi isn't a rational number, and here phi over pi is a rational number. Now, the difference between phi prime and phi may, as I say, be unbelievably small compared in any Euclidean sense, in a Euclidean distance sense, and indeed it may be much, much, much smaller than the accuracy with which the phase shifter can ever be set experimentally. And that's why it seems kind of crazy to attribute significance to this difference. But the point is, if you believe that these p-adic distances are the more fundamental and more physical distance functions we talk about in state space, then actually the distance between these two universes is very large, even though the Euclidean distance may be tiny. Now indeed I am proposing, and this is the primitive assumption here, that IU is a primitive notion in physics. We should think of all the laws of physics derivable from somehow from this geometry. Now if you accept that to be true, then it naturally follows from that, it's a consequence of that assumption, that the p-adic metric is the more physically relevant metric than the Euclidean metric. And so U2 and U3 are really very, very far apart. It would take a big perturbation, an enormously big perturbation, an unrealistically big perturbation, to take you from the universe U2 to U3 relative to this p-adic distance. All right, so we've got an interesting result here, purely based on very simple ideas in number theory, the sort of transcendence of cosine, if you like, which tells us that if, say, experiment A lies on the invariant set, which you could think of as measuring momentum of the particle, then B doesn't, or conversely, if you measure B, then A doesn't lie on the invariant set. So we've kind of got the Heisenberg uncertainty principle just from, if you like, the number-theoretic non-commensurateness of phi and cosine phi. So what we're doing is we are violating the measurement assumption. We're saying that, for a given particle with a given ontic variable lambda, if we do this experiment, then this experiment is now off limits, or conversely, if we did the lower experiment with the particle with ontic variable lambda, this one is off limits. So there is this subtle interplay between what experiments are done and the values of the ontic variable. So we violate the measurement independence assumption. I've tried to convince you this is not fine-tuning. It's certainly fine-tuning if you believed Euclidean metrics were fundamental in state space, but if you believe p-adic metrics are fundamental, it's not fine-tuning. Because perturbation from here to here is a large amplitude perturbation in the p-adic sense. So what about free will and all that business? So I was sort of thinking about that, preparing this talk, and I was imagining a situation where Bob, where we do a kind of delayed choice experiment, where the particle, let's say, goes through the first beam splitter, and we've got Alice and Bob, and it's Bob decides whether he will do, if you like, a position measurement or a momentum measurement, so we do B or A, and Alice is going to choose the value of phi. Now, you could argue that there could be some conflict here, because suppose Alice decided to set phi such that cosine phi is rational, and Bob decided to do a position measurement, then there would be a conflict, it would be something incompatible. But we're kind of saved by a situation which has really boils down to this issue of non-computability. Certainly from an experimental point of view, as I've said, the difference between a cosine phi rational number or a phi over pi rational number can be much, much smaller than any sort of experimental accuracy with which you can set the experiment. But more generally, the theory would never allow Alice to actually predict what the structure of the invariant set would be at any point in this interferometer setup, and therefore can never know whether the structure of the invariant set is consistent with a which way measurement or an interferometer measurement. So this non-computability issue becomes, in a sense, an important one in sort of overcoming some of the conceptual paradoxes about delayed choice experiment. And in particular, if we just say free will is a situation where there are no constraints on what we want to do in life, there are certainly no constraints. Alice is not constrained. She does what she wants to do. She sets the system as she wants to set it, according to whatever criterion she may use. But there's nothing that's going to allow her to determine whether it's a cosine phi rational or a phi over pi rational measurement she's doing. All right. Am I doing on time, Mr. Chairman?
We're not really sort of. We've got about an hour and a half.
Let me see if I can just wrap up in a sort of about 5 to 10 minutes.
Yeah, sure. Fine.
Okay. I did want to sort of move. I just want to say a couple more things. The first of all is the whole issue of the Schrödinger equation and, let's say more generally, the de Broglie relations. How do they fit in to all this? So just think about general relativity for a moment, and one of the sort of basic notions in GR is that particles move on geodesics, and so in some sense it's the geodesics which determines the inertial properties of these particles. The geodesics themselves are a property of the surrounding space-time geometry. They're determined, the structure of the geodesics is determined by the surrounding space, the Riemann curvature of the space-time geometry. That geometry is manifest by the fact that geodesics generically diverge from each other. That's the Jacobi equation. So in GR, we have this idea that inertial properties are somehow inherited from the surrounding space-time geometry. Space-time geometry. So I want to kind of bring that notion to bear in this geometric model as well. But now we're thinking about state-space geometry. We're attributing something sort of primitive to a highly non-trivial geometry embedded in the Euclidean state-space. And again, trying to draw on this notion that somehow properties of particles in our physical world, in space-time, inherit this geometric structure in the surrounding state-space. Now, because of that complex number structure that I talked about, there's an inherent periodicity, which I've kind of represented by helices, if you like. It's a way of just representing the geometry of, well, I say complex numbers, but actually slightly more generally of quaternions. I didn't talk about this, but one can generalise that complex number construction to describe
quaternions. Now you've slipped that in. Can I ask the question?
Yeah.
Why quaternions?
Sorry?
Why quaternions? What have you put in extra jumping from complex numbers to quaternions?
Well, only insofar as it allows me then to link to spin states and things like that, quantum mechanics. But it's a natural, but the way I would put it is, it's a natural structure which exists on those bit strings. It's a natural, one can define permutation.
You're making an assumption.
Yes, yes, mate. But it leads to these kind of periodic structures in this fractal set. So this is where I get this notion that, sort of by analogy with the GR, that this periodic structure is kind of, it impresses itself on the inertial properties of particles in our space-time. So that's my picture, if you like, of de Broglie in passing. Now, so here I'm going very half-pieced and speculative, if you don't mind. But, you know, if any of this idea is worth anything, I think it will be worth something if it provides us with a new angle into how to marry gravity and quantum physics together. And by the way, I use the word quantum physics rather than quantum theory because I'm sort of departing from, this is not really quantum theory what I'm talking about. Quantum theory, perhaps I should just say this very briefly, quantum theory is a theory where the complex Hilbert space is a closed algebraic structure. It's closed under addition and multiplication. In my theory, although I can link the statistics of these trajectories to Hilbert space vectors, to Hilbert vectors, the Hilbert vectors are never algebraically complete. For any p or any n, no matter how big it is, there'll always be Hilbert space vectors which don't have any correspondence back to the trajectories. And so there's always this notion of counterfactual incompleteness. So this is where I depart from quantum theory. Anyway, so if this idea of the surrounding state-space geometry leaving its imprint, if you like, in our world, I'm saying that the de Broglie relations are part of that, maybe there's also something gravitational where the surrounding geometry of state-space imprints itself on our world. And there are two points I want to draw out here. One is that what would that mean in terms of generalizing GR? Well, it would mean, I'm writing this in a very schematic and illustrative way because I don't have a precise idea of what I'm trying to say here, but let me say it in general terms. Instead of moving from, so we move from G, so something self-contained in space-time, to something which sort of probes the surrounding structure of the state-space geometry. Just at a technical level, I would say, again, using p-adics, there's a measure called Ha measure. So the invariant set itself has measure zero in the embedded Euclidean space, but there's a perfectly well-defined measure to do integration, calculus integration, and it's called Ha measure. So in this picture I have, we're generalizing the right-hand side. No general relativist, I think, would ever want to mess around with the left-hand side. It's too beautiful to mess around with, but I think we can mess around with the right-hand side a bit, because that's a bit provisional. So my view is that we can generalize the right-hand side by bringing in some of this surrounding structure from the invariant set. And maybe that's what we see when we look at galaxies and see there's more mass, seems to be more mass than we think there ought to be from our space-time. So I'm very much hoping that the LHC doesn't find supersymmetric particles, because I think there may be another explanation for dark matter. And whilst we're at it, there is a generic divergence of trajectories, which I talked about, which could be the basis of dark energy as well. I did want to, very briefly, just mention the point that we also need some way of converging trajectories in order we get a compact set. And again, Roger's ideas about convergence of state space, phase space, during at space-time singularities, I think is probably quite important. Okay, so I think there's a way to resolve quantum physics keeping realism, determinism, and local causality. We violate measurement independence, but I don't think that poses any constraint on human free will, and nor is it fine-tuned if you take this view that the Piatic metric is the natural metric of state space. So just on my very last point. So in my work in climate, we often think about how we approximate. We've got some non-dynamical system, which is rather complicated and has a fractal attractors. I mean, just think of Lorentz 63 as an example. How would you kind of approximate that very simply? Well, one simple thing you could do is to take a, if you remember the Lorentz equations, the Lorentz attractor has this double, sort of two lobes, if you like, it's a bit like a butterfly in state space. So you could think of a double well potential function, introduce a bit of stochasticity, and you can generate a lot of the statistics of the Lorentz attractor that way. You lose the beautiful geometry, but you get a lot of the structure. So my sort of view is that it could well be that there is a linkage here to Bohmian theory, and that what we call the quantum potential is really one of these sort of coarse-grained, representation of this geometry. Now the problem is, if you do this coarse graining, so the support of the potential function is over the whole of the Euclidean space, then all these arguments about counterfactual incompleteness and resolving the Bell theorem and so on in favour of the measurement independence assumption, they go out the window, because now every point in state space has the same ontological value as any other point. So I think there is a way to marry this idea to Bohmian theory in a way that might help resolve some of the, I suppose, problems that people sometimes raise about Bohmian theory and non-locality, because this is a way to really, I think, overcome the non-locality issue. When I say the word non-locality, it's become a bit of a buzz, it's almost become like a weasel word that people use it without really defining it. I'm using it in this definition of Bell, that it means no longer are events determined by data in the past light cone. And if you believe that's true, that must be true, then I think this provides a way out. And it also provides, I mean, it's an interesting thought that one might be, if one did Bohmian mechanics using Ha measures instead of Euclidean measures, maybe as a way to recover all the Bohmian theory without having to be non-local in this sense.
Okay, fine. Please.
Yes, Tim, I'm very inclined to believe you, especially since the added geometry is a particular case of the ultrametric geometry, which plays a role in the uncertainty principle. But, okay, which choice of B would you recommend?
That's a good question.
137?
Well, when I wear my physicist hat, I like to think of P as somehow representing the ratio of gravitational and electromagnetic forces. So
it's not necessarily a prime number, or is it?
Well, okay, so that's another good question. So when I wear my slightly more mathematical hat on, I have p equals 2 to the n plus 1. Mm-hmm. Now that could be a Fermat prime. So the prime numbers that have that structure are Fermat primes. One of the unknown things about Fermat primes, is whether there seems to be, when I talk to my number theory colleagues, evidence that there may only be finite number of Fermat primes. I think we don't know any of them above 17 or something, some very small number. So when I wear my mathematical hat on, I like to think that P is the largest possible Fermat prime. So in slightly Dirac-ian mode, it may be that the ratio of gravitational to I'm being crazy here. That the ratio of gravitational to electromagnetic forces might be determined by the largest Fermat prime. Well, so how's that for an answer? It's rather speculative.
That's an answer.
Yes.
I'm always somewhat worried about the idea of, you know, whether a number is rational or not.
Yes.
But curiously, in the things I've been doing recently, which I'm perhaps rather ill-advisedly going to talk about later on today, involves ideas of non-compositive geometry.
Yes.
And the examples of this depend upon, I mean, if you have a torus and you have a curve that winds around the torus, and you want to factor out, well, you have a vector field on the torus, which if you follow the vectors, it may or may not close up.
Yes.
And the ones that don't close up are the ones that the space of these geodesics, or these trajectories in a certain sense, forms one of these non-commutative geometries.
Right.
And it's an example of exactly this kind that comes in in what I was going to talk about.
Yes.
But it's curious that it has this relation, perhaps, to what you're saying here, that it does depend critically on whether the angle of this thing gives you one that closes or that goes on forever.
Yes.
And it's just the sort of thing you're talking
about. So, if I just make a slightly facetious comment, that when we go like that, you know, like you did, we're waggling our arm or our hand about in physical space. And that clearly, you know, any theory where it mattered whether your hand was like that or like that, you know, is, you know, we don't want the theory to be sensitive to that.
Yeah.
But I don't know exactly how it fits in your theory, but where this issue becomes relevant is not your position of your hand in physical space. It's the value of parameters and variables in state space. And it's moving, it's considering, you know, the world that exists, and a world, you know, if you like, that might exist, but might, you know, who knows, where everything is the same apart from, say, one variable where we've changed something to something else. And what I'm trying to argue is that our intuition that Euclidean distances are the natural distance of choice, if you like, for that type of situation, maybe we may be being misled by our intuition, and that...
Well, this space isn't a physical space either, I'm talking about. But whether it's connected with what you're saying, it's rather intriguing
that
it seems to there's suggestive connection.
Yeah, well, that is, I just do think that an awful lot, I mean, the wonderful thing about fractal geometry is it brings in all this number theory ideas, which I just think are so wonderful, you know, that you can start
bringing
in lots of the structure.
You have time, you have a process or other time. You have steps, right?
Yes.
Along this.
Yes.
T1 is a set of steps along this. Time was an asymmetry period, so you're bringing the notion of time asymmetry or not?
Well, yes. I mean, what I skipped over was I talked. And again, this is something which goes back to Roger's work, that measurements are associated with these kind of instabilities, periods where these trajectories are unstable. I've always thought that, you know, it reminds me a little bit of Everettian theory, you know, which has our world splitting. Well, actually, there's nothing splitting, it's just that you're just seeing a level of the iterate, or an iterate below what you can, say, directly see becoming manifest by this instability. But there will also be later periods in the universe, because to produce a compact, for the whole geometry to be somehow compact in state space, there have got to be corresponding periods where trajectories are converging, the sort of opposite has got to happen somewhere. And that's where I draw, Roger, on your ideas about, you know, you particularly drew on the information loss in black holes being regions where state space is collapsing, and that would be the sort of, this would be, if that's the, if this, if the divergence is the yin, then the collapse in space time singularities would be the yang, and the whole thing together. It's a bit like in the Lorentz, well, not so much Lorentz attractor, but there are other types of fractal attractors where in most of the attractor, most of the parts of phase space, the trajectories are diverging, but there's kind of concentrated regions in state space where they're all converging back again, and it's the integral of all that that gives you this structure.
Okay, last question to Basil.
I just want to make a comment to pick up on what Roger said about the quantum potential being a coarse grain of something and the like. And what I've been looking at is, in fact, non-commutative geometry.
Oh, really?
Yes, and I've been looking at Collins' tangent groupoids.
Sure, yeah.
Where you can actually see if you embed it in the Moyal algebra, which to me is not a classical algebra, it's the quantum mechanics in a particular form. Mm. And there you find that you can approximate